Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Fresh Prince Project, How the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air Remixed America by Chris Palmer. Read by Kevin R. Free. Prologue. Will stood nervously at the head of the table. There was so much beauty around him. Palm trees that grew sideways out of white sand. A mist that dropped each morning and enveloped their wonderful caravan. A welcome warm rain that seemed to know when to step aside and let glorious golden rays touch down wherever they might, in service of their technicolor dreams. At night, a soundtrack, waves crashed on rock. They couldn't have been on a happier errand. Nothing would steal this safety. It don't get no better than this. And they were allowed to take the bathrobes home. But he knew their lives were about to change. At the end of the fifth season of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, Will Smith announced that he'd be taking 25 members of the cast and crew to Hawaii, plus significant others, and put them up in a 5-star hotel for a week, all on his dime. The Grand Wailea Resort in Maui overlooked a clear blue bay where dolphins would pop their curious heads out of the water as gulls sang their morning songs. Will had planned a dinner for their second day at the resort at the Sandy Beach Oasis. Shelley Jensen, longtime Fresh Prince director and determined invitee, struggled on through a combination of too much to drink the night before and a bit of stomach flu. The guests had all split up and spent the preceding day getting massages, riding ATVs, or hitting the links, which is where Shelley found himself, throwing up just before teeing off with Will, who thought the whole thing was hilarious. The mood was high, the tide was low, and the group felt relaxed. Will took a seat at the head of the table as the food and vino flowed freely. No palate went unsatisfied. No stomach underserved. A la carte or the entire cart, their revelry would stretch into the wee hours. Then Will cleared his throat and stood up. The sound of gentle waves crashed behind him hypnotically like a muted heartbeat. He fidgeted a bit and swayed unsteadily on the balls of his feet. After nervously careening through a brief, unprepared, heartfelt soliloquy, he paused. Next season will be our last on The Fresh Prince. They all knew it was coming. They just hadn't expected the news to arrive in the way it had. Not words floating on soft air from a kind, nervous boy who couldn't make eye contact. You see, there's no good or easy way to end any show, and definitely not for a show like this one. But usually it happens in incredibly jarring fashion. Red Fox dying on set, casts returning from lunch only to be relieved of their security cards, haphazard notes left on dressing room doors. Once, Jensen heard workers dismantling a set during rewrites. No one had bothered to tell them to pack their things. But this was different. Will felt the full weight of this franchise on his shoulders, and he hated to let people down. This was personal. This was a family he loved. But he knew inside he couldn't separate himself from the decision. Discarded cast and crew were oftentimes treated with no more care than a brown and brittle Christmas tree. Needles everywhere, left on the side of the road deep into March. But Will was emotionally invested. He was basically giving us a year's notice, Jensen told me. The show certainly would have been picked up for a 7th season, but Will's movie career was taking off. In our business, to get a year's notice was unprecedented. No one was expecting to hear that because we weren't thinking that far down the road. But Will had already released huge hits in Bad Boys and Independence Day and was commanding $20 million a picture during breaks from TV filming sessions. He was on the brink of becoming the biggest star in Hollywood, yet still wrestled a crisis of conscience about moving on. This troupe had, after all, saved his life, brought him back from the abyss of both creative waywardness and extreme debt. But it was more than that. He fell in love with them. With the fight against his insecurity, with the safety of it all, with the promise of what would come. How do you repay those who had saved your life? He felt connected to the cast, as he would years after. Their very mention could wet his expressive, sad eyes, stop him in his tracks, crack his voice. James Avery especially had been more than a senior castmate. He was a mentor, a soothing force for an unsure young man every time he pulled Will aside and placed one of his enormous hands on the side of his head. Will never wanted the Fresh Prince to stop. Not the show, but the idea, because family never does. Tatiana, adopted sister, was set to be wed. Alfonso had lined up a new show. Karen had just had a baby. What else lay ahead, he could not know. Will, just 25 then, played the part and convened the toast quietly. The main course had arrived. Introduction. There was enough nervous energy to go around. Walkthroughs had gone well enough. The actors seemed comfortable with one another. Bonding sessions at Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles did wonders for their chemistry. He thought the script was sound. There was, of course, the customary interference from overbearing network executives, and they were on an unusual schedule, but these things were hard to gauge. Could he have done more? What, after all, did he know about hip-hop? By his own admission, not much. And who the hell was Will Smith? 32-year-old Andy Borowitz, clad in a black dress shirt, his shoulder-length brown hair pulled into a ponytail, stepped out onto the studio floor, hoping for a sign. He took a deep breath. It was either going to work, or it wasn't. As the show's creator, he had the most to lose. The audience filed into Studio H with a murmuring low tide, equal parts restlessness and anticipation. It was a sound craved by both actors and crew alike. Rehearsals and table reads behind them, this was the real thing. "Bring your real energy on the night," implored James Avery, who played family patriarch Uncle Phil. His baritone soothed. An accomplished theater actor, he was the show's anchor and go-to sage for inexperienced members of the cast. His dressing room door was always open. One needed only to follow the sounds of John Coltrane or Miles Davis. There was some Charlie Parker, too. An odd collection of actors and personalities from wide-ranging backgrounds and varying levels of experience had gathered here on this early summer night in 1990. It was time to shoot the pilot for the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. For some, it was just a job. For others, a lifeline. They knew not where any of this was bound. In Hollywood, you never did. This gig, even more than most, didn't have much of a hope. In fact, to call it a pilot was inaccurate. This was a presentation to be completed in 4 days instead of the customary 6, so the network could save money. Its star was pop rapper Will Smith, a first-time actor who would lip-sync the other actor's lines during scenes to keep his place. The network put that all aside, instead counting on his boundless energy and infectious likability to deliver something fit for broadcast. The production borrowed a rickety studio space at Sunset Gower Studios on Melrose Avenue from a canceled soap opera called Generations, starring an early career Vivica A. Fox. If the actors walked too heavily or nudged a wall, it shook, a too on-the-nose representation of the show's chances at success. But that was a discussion for another day. There was a job to do. "Oh, that's beautiful, darling." Fastidious costumer Judy Richmond's signature line of reinforcement bellowed as she scurried about making last-minute adjustments to hats and blouses. The actors took their marks. "Quiet," the stage manager beckoned. The audience fell silent. Borowitz took a slow, deep breath. He could still go to law school. The LSAT books were still in his closet, hidden behind sweaters. But there was no turning back here and now. This was real. But real didn't mean it was going to work. "Action!" Smith burst through the front door and into America's living room. There was a beat, then a backdraft of raw energy. He hadn't so much entered the frame as he had exploded. One, born and raised. The house on Woodcrest Avenue stood proud. It was in a row of about 40 houses and its concrete facade sat just up a dozen steps or so from the sidewalk. It's where his imagination would rumble, then tumble out of his head and into the world in a jumble of personal, private, funny, and silly machinations that only he knew. And often.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.